to thank Jay Gang for organizing this conference. I'm very pleased to be here to talk about so recent developments in this theory of homologous manifolds and to visit Korea a second time. So it's a pleasure for me to do these lectures. So maybe I will first start by giving a general sketch of what I'm going to talk about in the lecture. So in the first two lectures, I will do some generalities. About CNC surfaces in homogeneous free manifolds. So only Riemannian. So CMC will be the usual notation for constant mean curvature. And then I will talk more specifically on results on minimal surfaces in the Heisenberg group, nil, which is one of these homogeneous free manifolds. Okay, so basically, apart from this talk, which is a kind of introductory talk to the homogeneous manifolds, my talks and those of Pablo and those of Laurent will be most independent. So. First, let me do some general things about homogeneous manifolds. So what is a homogeneous manifold? Riemannian manifold. Well, it's a homogeneous manifold means that if you take any two points P and Q in the manifolds, then there exists an isometry that maps the point P to the point Q. So, in other words, the isometry group acts transitively on the manifold. So intuitively, it means that the manifold looks the same everywhere. Right? If you live at this point, you cannot tell that you live at this precise point. Because if you live at this point, the manifold looks exactly the same as if you live around this point. So this is the meaning of homogeneous manifold. So why do people are interested in CMC surfaces there? Okay. Well, there are several reasons. First, people started to investigate minimal surfaces and constant mean curvature surfaces in Euclidean space. This is the most natural one. And then, naturally, you have extension to other spaces of constant curvature, as the spheres and the hyperbolic spaces. But then, if you want to generalize the theory, constant curvature is a very strong condition because you have very few manifolds, ambient manifolds with constant curvature. So you need something, a condition a little bit more relaxed. And the natural one is to be homogeneous. So we will see in a few moments the classification of homogeneous manifolds in the three-dimensional case. And also, if one expects to have some classification results, for example, there is a very famous theorem, which is the Hopf theorem. The Hopf theorem say that in Euclidean space, there is, up to isometry, only one CMC H sphere, if I fix H. If I fix the value of mean curvature, there is exactly one CMC H sphere, which is the round sphere. And obviously, this uniqueness theorem is up to isometries, up to ambient isometries, because if I take a sphere, and if I apply a translation to it, then I get another sphere. But from the point of view of this classification, these two spheres are the same, because we consider objects up to isometries. Okay? So we want to obtain these kinds of theorems, classification theorems. If you take any ambient manifold, well, it's not very reasonable to accept such simple results. For example, if you have a manifold which has constant curvature minus 1 in some region and constant curvature 0 in some other region, then you will have different types of spheres. So you will not... It will be very difficult to have some kind of classification results, some kind of uniqueness results. In the case of homogeneous manifolds, we will expect such results, because also in this case, we will expect results of uniqueness up to isometries, up to ambient isometries. So a very important result that motivated this theory was the Abresh-Rosenberg theorem. So the Abresh-Rosenberg theorem is the following. is that any CMC sphere in a manifold e kappa tau, I will explain later what it means, is rotational. Okay, so this is a generalization of Hopf theorem. It's a Hopf-Tight theorem. Okay, and rotational spheres are classified, and they are unique. If you fix the value of h, either there is no rotational sphere, either there is a unique one. Okay, so it's a Hopf-type uniqueness. And obviously, this is also up to ambient isometries. So I will explain right now what is e kappa tau, which will be one of a particular type of homogeneous free manifolds. So this theorem was a very important theorem in the theory. It motivated many results in this direction. So now maybe let me explain what is the classification, what are these manifolds that we call e kappa tau. So let's start with dimension 2. In dimension 2, if you consider a simply connected homogeneous manifold, then you only have three types, because in dimension 2, homogeneous implies constant curvature. So if you consider only simply connected ones, then you have three types. You have Euclidean plane R2, you have round spheres, S2, of curvature kappa, positive spheres, and you have hyperbolic plane, H2 of kappa, of constant curvature kappa negative. Okay? So up to homotheses, you have three cases. Positive curvature, negative curvature, or zero curvature. In the case of dimension 3, it's more complicated. Okay, so I will call M bar 3, a simply connected homogeneous manifold. You have three main cases, depending on the dimension of the isometry group. First case is when the isometry group, which I'm not denoted by isom of M, has dimension 6. Then you have space forms, R3, S3 of kappa, H3 of kappa, constant curvature surfaces. Then you have the ones with isometry group of dimension 4. Then you have a two-parameter family, which I will denote by E3 of kappa tau. E3 of kappa tau, where kappa and tau satisfy the condition kappa minus 4 tau squared different from zero. And then you have the case where the isometry group has dimension 3. And in this case, you have several kinds of Lie groups. But among them, there is one which has additional property, which is the Lie group SOL. Okay, so when isometry group of M has dimension 3, you have some Lie groups, among which there is SOL3. Okay, so why do I consider SOL3? It's because of the so-called Thurston geometries. So I'm not going into details about what is a Thurston geometry. But roughly speaking, a Thurston geometry is a homogeneous manifold, simply connected, associated with a group of diffeomorphism that acts by isometries on it. And you require two things. You require that the isometry group is maximal. It means that it cannot be included in a larger, in a strictly larger subgroup acting also by isometries on the manifold. And you also require the existence of compact quotients. There must exist a compact quotient of this manifold, compatible with the axion of the group. So this is what we call the Thurston geometry. This is the geometries that appear in the so-called geometrization conjecture. And there are eight kinds of them, of these Thurston geometries. The first kinds are these ones, R3, S3, H3, the space forms. Then there are four kinds in this family, which I will explain later, and there is SOL3. And the other homogeneous manifolds that appear in the classification, either they don't have compact quotients, either their isometric group is not maximal. So now let's come back to this, E kappa tau. So these manifolds here with a dimension group of with an isometric group of dimension 4, they form a two-parameter family E of kappa tau with this condition. And when we have kappa minus 4 tau squared equals 0, then we will get R3 and S3 of some other constant here. So they go in a two-parameter family together with round spheres and R3. So E of kappa tau has some properties. There is a Riemannian fibration pi that's a Riemannian vibration or submersion. Okay. We have a unit vector field tangent to the fiber, xi, unit vector field tangent to the fibers. That means that d pi of xi is 0. So if we recall vertical, and saying that this is a Riemannian fibration means that this is an isometry for horizontal vectors. Horizontal vectors are vectors that are orthogonal to xi. So Riemannian fibration means that pi is an isometry for horizontal vector. And what is tau? Tau is called the bundle curvature. And it's defined by this formula, the derivative of xi with respect to x. So here, this is the ambient connection, nabla with a bar or with a hat, maybe. Nabla hat is the Riemannian connection of E of kappa tau. So we have this formula. It is a wedge product of x and xi, and you have this coefficient tau here, which is called the bundle curvature. I will give later a geometric interpretation of this coefficient. So this is the general properties of E kappa tau. So now what kind of manifolds do we have? We have five kinds of manifolds in these families, according to the signs of kappa, the sign of kappa, and according to the fact that tau is zero or not. So we can summarize this in the following table. So when kappa is negative, 0, positive, and tau can be 0, or tau can be not 0. Well, first of all, when tau is 0, actually what we get is just a product. When tau is 0, we get a product. E of kappa tau is nothing but m2 of kappa times r, with a product metric. Okay? So, in this first line, you have, when the curvature is negative, the, This is the curvature of the base of the fibration, kappa. We get H2 of kappa times R here. Here we got R3. And here we have S2 of kappa cross R. And when tau is not zero, we have other manifolds. So here, when kappa is zero, we have nil, which is called the Heisenberg group. When kappa is negative, we have the universal cover of the Lie group PSL to R. Okay, and when kappa is positive, we have the so-called Berger spheres and Brown spheres. So this is a classification. So in this classification, we have all the ones with an isometric group of dimension 4, plus R3 here, and round spheres here, which have an isometric group of dimension 6. Okay, so now let's go more into details of each different types. Ah, maybe I should say a word about the dimension of the isometric group. What are the isometries that we lose here? Well, we keep three dimensions of translations, but we have only one dimension of rotations. We will have only rotations with respect to vertical fibers, only these ones. We don't have any rotation with respect to other geodesics or something like that, other than vertical ones. So we just have four dimensions of isometries. Okay, so maybe let me go into more into details about the different types of manifolds. Of the isometric group, you mean? It's 6, 4, or 3. Because if you have to look at the stabilizer of a point, it will give you a subgroup of SO... So three, yes.
Let me ask one thing. What can you say about the classification simply connected to homogeneous 14-dimensional manifold?
Four-dimensional?
Yeah. Can you say it like this way?
Ah, I think it's more complicated. I don't know exactly, but the classification of four-dimensional. I think it's known, yes, but...
Are you talking about four-dimensional manifolds?
Can I explain like this way, something like that, yeah. Are you ready?
Yeah.
Okay, everyone, that's okay.
Okay, so let's start with, for instance, for the product, there is nothing much to say, I think. So maybe I will start with PSL2R. So PSL2R, a good way to see it is as universal cover of the because I will take the universal cover of the unitary tangent bundle to H2. Okay, so what is PSL2R? Tilde. It will be identified with universal cover of H2 of the unit tangent bundle to H2, which I denote by U of H2. So how does it work? Well, the isometric group of H2 is PSL2R. And if you consider a point P in H2 and a vector V tangent to P, unitary, and another point Q with another unit vector W, then there exists exactly one isometry that maps PV to QW. There is exactly one isometry. So this says that since the isometric group of H2 is PSL2R, I mean, I consider only positive isometries, so which reserve orientation. This says that you can identify PSL2R with the unit tangent bundle, like this. So on the unit tangent bundle, we will put what we call the Sasaki metric. So it works like this. So the Sasaki metric. So we consider a point P in H2 and a point V, a vector V, sorry, tangent to H2 and with norm 1, okay, small v. And we consider capital V, something belonging to T PV of U H2. And we want to define the norm of this V. So what we do is once we consider a curve. So let alpha of T, P of T, V of T, be a curve in U H2. So that means that V of T belongs to U P of T H2, H2, okay, and such that alpha dot of 0 is capital V. Then we put definition the square norm of V of capital V at the point PV will be the sum of two terms, a horizontal part. So pi here is the canonical projection from UH2 to H2. Plus a vertical term, which will be dv dt at zero, square. And I could put here any positive constant A. Okay, so this is the Sasaki metric. What is good with this point of view is that we can see where is the vibration. We can see clearly that the vibration is just the canonical projection here. So U of H2, it will be preserved by universal cover here. So this will give the canonical projection, the Riemannian vibration, from PSL to R to H2. So with this point of view, we see the vibration in a rather clear way. So now let's compute the metric. Let's compute the metric. So first I will consider a conformal parametrization of H2. H2, which I denote by phi, phi, x1, x2. I will put lambda as a conformal factor, so the metric will be lambda square d x1 square plus d x2 square. And so we have a parametrization of UH2 like this. How to characterize a unit vector? For example, you can consider its angle with the direction of x1, with the direction dx1. So you can use the following parametrization. X1, x2, theta is mapped to phi of x1, x2, and to 1 over lambda to have a unit vector times cos theta d dx1 plus sin theta d dx2. Okay? Okay, so now you can compute the things. So you compute the derivative of this. You parametrize the curve by x1 of t, x2 of t, theta of t. you compute the covariant derivative, and you get the following formula, which is a little bit complicated, but it will be the same formula for every homogeneous manifold. So this is the following formula. Norm of V, at the point PV, will be equal to lambda square times x1 dot square plus x2 dot square plus the following term, A over lambda square times lambda theta prime theta dot plus x2 dot d lambda dx1 minus x1 dot d lambda dx2. Okay? So this is the Sasaki norm of this vector V. So this gives the metric, the expression of the metric on UH2. So now we take the universal cover. So here theta is defined modulo 2 pi. So in the universal cover, theta will be defined modulo nothing, it will be any real, and so this gives the expression of a metric. And we do a convenient change of parameter. We will set x3 equals epsilon square root of a theta with epsilon plus 1 or minus 1. And for the conformal factor lambda, we will put the usual conformal factor for the hyperbolic metric, which is the following. And finally, so this is defined when this quantity is positive. So it's for x1 squared plus x2 squared less than 4 over kappa. Minus. Kappa is negative here. I mean, in the case of PSL2R. And finally, we get the expression of the metric on PSL2R, which is the following. So it's a little bit complicated. So ds squared equals lambda 2 dx1 squared plus dx2 squared plus tau lambda x1 dx2 minus x2 dx1 plus dx3 squared. So this is the metric on PSL2R, tilde. So it's defined for any x3 and for x1 and x2 in this disk. Okay, so this is for PSL2R. Now for the Berger spheres, it's very similar. Berger spheres are some metric on SU2. SU2. And SU2, so SU2 is topologically the round sphere. And SU2, you can see it as, SO3. You can identify it in the same way with the unit tangent bundle to the sphere. It's exactly the same procedure. If you take a point on a two sphere and a vector, a unit vector at this point, and you take another point and another unit vector, then there exists exactly one positive isometry of the sphere that maps the first point, first vector to the second point and second vector. Okay? So in this way, you can identify the isometry group, the positive isometries of the two spheres with the unit tangent bundle to the sphere. So this gives an identification with SO3 and US2. And then you take the universal cover. So first, you do exactly the same procedure as here, and which will give exactly the same formula. But the difference is that in the case of the sphere, you don't have a global chart. You have two charts because you have to remove the fiber at infinity. So what you get with this procedure is exactly the same formula, but with kappa positive, and it is defined here on R3. But this is not a complete metric, because you have removed one point on the two-sphere. So what you get is a non-complete manifold, which is the Berger sphere minus one fiber. Okay? And then you have to do the same thing for another chart, another choice of coordinates that recovers the other part of the sphere, and do some identification, and then you get the Berger spheres. So topologically, the Berger spheres are exactly the round spheres. The difference, another way to see Berger spheres, is to consider the Hopf vibration on the round sphere and to shrink or to enlarge the fibers. So this gives another metric on the sphere, which has an isometric group of dimension 4 and which is also the Berger sphere, the same. So now, the Heisenberg group. The Heisenberg group...
Yes.
It's left invariant metric on PSL2R and on SU2, yes. Sorry? As a curvature, as I will explain later. Yes. The sectional curvature, you mean? I will tell you later. Yes. So what I'm going to explain here is that in fact we have a common setting for every homogeneous spaces. So the Berger spheres and the PSL2R are obtained like this. Now for Heisenberg, it's also the same that will hold. So NIL3 is also a Lie group, it's a group of matrix, but in fact we don't use this group of matrix. We see NIL as R3 with this metric when kappa is 0. So when kappa is 0, lambda is just 1.
Let me ask one. What is tau? Tau is one parameter?
Yes, tau, you have a choice. It becomes, yes, because in the Sasaki metric, you can put this coefficient A. It depends on tau and kappa. Yes. It depends on tau and kappa. Yes, you have two parameters. Yes, kappa is a curvature of the base. Yes, it's H2 of curvature kappa. And then you have tau. So this tau comes from the choice that you have in the Sasaki metric. In the Sasaki metric, you have two terms, and you can do any linear combination. So up to homotacy, you can choose one coefficient to be 1, and so you have the choice for the other one. And so this comes from tau. Actually, I have this. Ah, yes, I forgot to... Tau has some expression in terms of A. Tau precisely is... tau is A epsilon square root of A kappa. Okay. So you have this expression for the metric, and it works exactly the same for Berger spheres, apart from the fact that you have to remove one fiber. So for NIL, it's also the same. NIL, you can consider this metric. So NIL is not obtained as a Sasaki metric on the unit tangent bundle, because if you do this procedure for NIL, for R2, if you start with R2, you will get just Euclidean space, Euclidean free space. So NIL is obtained in a different way. It's a group of matrix, but you can see that you can put actually R3 with this metric here, with lambda equal to 1, because kappa is 0. So NIL3 is the same. With kappa equals 0. And the product space, well, the product space, you can realize that, in fact, it's also the same when tau is 0. Because when tau is 0, what you get is just the metric on S2 or H2 plus the term coming from the factor R. So you get the product metric. So this actually, this works for every E kappa tau. So this will be the common setting of all this family of homogeneous manifolds. Okay, so now let's see some properties of this. So it will be convenient to introduce a particular field, E1, E2, E3. So in the case where tau is not 0, otherwise it doesn't work. We consider a canonical field, E1, E2, E3. I'm not writing precisely what it is. You have the formulas in the notes. It's quite complicated. I mean, except in nil, it's quite complicated. But what is important is that E3 is a vertical field Xi, and it is just d dx3. In this coordinate, the projection pi the fibers are given by fixing x1 and x2. Sorry? Ah, yes. This one, yes. Yes. This one is not, it's isolated from the others. Okay, so we have this canonical field. And what is important with this canonical field is that the Christoffel symbols are constant in this field. So it's very useful to do the computations. And you can write, for example, the sectional curvatures. Sectional curvatures are the following. So of E2, E3, is tau square. E1, E3 is also tau square. And E1, E2 is kappa minus 4 tau square, minus 3 tau square, sorry. So again comes this coefficient kappa minus 4 tau square, because you see that kappa minus 4 tau square is the difference between this and this. So in the case where kappa minus 4 tau square is 0, we have a constant curvature space. So we get the space force. So H3 does not appear in this classification because H3 does not possess this Riemannian fibration, contrarily to Euclidean space and to round spheres. Okay, so an important property of the what is the geometric meaning of this tau is the following. If you take a curve, gamma, so I see M2 of kappa here, and I consider a closed curve gamma enclosing a domain omega. And I take a horizontal lift of this curve, so a horizontal lift in E kappa tau means a curve that projects onto gamma and which is horizontal. Horizontal means everywhere perpendicular to the vertical direction. Gamma tilde is a horizontal lift. The following happens. So these two points, the two endpoints of gamma tilde, they lie on the same fiber. But maybe they are not the same, because there is no reason why they should be the same. But they belong to the same fiber, and the difference of height here, the difference of height, is proportional to area. It's 2 times tau times the area of omega. So this is the geometric meaning of this quantity tau here. If you take a horizontal lift, then the endpoints have a difference of height, which is this. So it means that you can climb by keeping on a horizontal path. It's like having walking on a horizontal path, and at the end, you climbed. That's what it means. Okay. So something very important is the isometries of this E kappa tau. So when tau is zero, you get a closed curve, because when tau is zero, you just have a product. So the horizontal lift lies in some slice, some H2 or some S2 times a constant height. What can we say about isometries? So what is important is not only the dimension, but also the number of components, of connected components. isometries of M. When tau is zero, you have a product metric. So the isometry group is the product of the isometry groups of M2 and R. So you have four connected components. Because an isometry of M2 cross R can either reverse or preserve the orientation of the fibers, and also either reverse or preserve the orientation of the basis. So when tau is zero, you have four connected components. And when tau is not zero, you only have two connected components. And what is very important is that every isometry preserves orientation. So here, when tau is zero, what you have in particular is reflections. You have reflections with respect to vertical planes and to horizontal planes. But here, when tau is not zero, you don't have this. And we will see later that it will be a very important problem with respect to what is called the Alexandrov theorem, which is also a result of uniqueness of round spheres. So this is very important to have this in mind. OK. So, I think I've given the more important points about these general manifolds. So now let's come to, more specifically, to constant mean curvature surfaces. So when we do the theory of submanifolds, not specially constant mean curvature submanifolds, something which is very important is to find necessary and sufficient condition for a surface to be isometrically immersed in your ambient manifold. So you have what you call the Gauss and Kodaty equation. So it's a problem of isometric immersion. So first, I will consider the following. I consider a surface M2 included, immersed, isometrically immersed in a manifold M3. Then you have two equations, which are the Gauss equation K so what is this? K is the intrinsic curvature of M, K bar is the sectional curvature of M bar, and that S is a determinant of the second fundamental form of M2. So this is the Gauss equation. It's always satisfied. And you also have another one, which is the Kodaty equation, which is something about the derivative of S, and which is the following. Nabla X S of Y minus Nabla Y S of X minus S of bracket XY equals R bar of xyn. Well, this is the Riemannian tensor, the Riemannian curvature tensor of M bar. Okay, so this is the Kodaty equation. So now the question is there a converse to this? This holds when you have effectively a surface isometrically immersed in an ambient manifold. You have generalization in either in other dimensions and codimensions, but I'm only talking about this specific case. So a very important question is there a converse to this? It means that if you have a surface M2 with a certain metric, and you also need to prescribe the second fundamental form, and if these two equations are satisfied, is it true that you have an isometric immersion with these first and second fundamental forms? First problem is that the problem is not well defined in general, because here, what happens? In this equation appears some extrinsic objects, like k-bar and like this. So in order to define correctly the equations, you need to know this and this. So in some sense, you need to already know what is the immersion. But in the case of space forms, it turns out that this term is just a constant. It's a constant curvature of the space form, and this is zero. So in the case of space forms, this is a constant in space forms. This is a constant, and this is zero. So what happens? It happens that the equations are well defined. You only have intrinsic objects. I mean, you have to prescribe the first fundamental form, which defines k and nabla, and you have to prescribe the second fundamental form, which gives s. So if you have this data, the surface and the first and second fundamental form, and then the Gauss and quantity equation are well defined because the intrinsic object disappeared in the case of space forms. And it turns out, it's a classical theorem, that they are also sufficient in the case of space forms. It means that if you have M with the first and second fundamental form satisfying this, then you can recover the isometric immersion. So now what happens in E kappa tau? In E kappa tau, it will not be so simple, but still you can say things. How much time do I have?
0 or 10.
0 or 10. So it will be 10. Okay, so in E kappa tau, what happens? So let me write these equations. Gauss' equation is the following. Quadratic equation is the following. So what appears here? Appears two things. This function nu is the scalar product of xi, the vertical direction, with n, which is the unit normal. N is the unit normal to the surface. And t is a vector field, which is the projection on the tangent plane of the vertical field xi. So you have your surface like this. The tangent plane is here, so the surface is like this. Xi is here. And you project, and this gives a vector t. Okay? So these are the Gauss and quadratic equation. So what appears in this equation? Of course, you have something depending on the first fundamental form, like the curvature and the connection, the Riemannian connection. And you also have things depending on the second fundamental form, such as the shape operator here, S. And you also have this nu, this function nu, which is n product with xi. So n is a normal, the unit normal. And this vector field t. So the initial data, you will have to prescribe also these two quantities. So you will have to prescribe first and second fundamental form, this function nu and t, this vector field t. And nu and t must satisfy nu square plus norm of t square equals 1, because it's a norm of xi. No? But it turns out that these equations are necessary, because it's always the Gauss and quadratic equation, but they are not any more sufficient to recover the immersion. You need to add two more equations, which are the following. You need two more equations. Nabla xt equals nu sx minus tau jx and d nu of x plus sx minus tau jx t equals 0, where j is nothing but the rotation of angle pi over 2 on the tangent plane. So you have these two additional equations. They are also necessary. Where does it come from? Well, remember that you have this formula. This is a formula for the derivative of the vector field psi. And if you take the projection on the tangent part in this equation, you get this. And if you take the normal part in this equation, you get this. So they are also necessary conditions. And so the theorem is that this set of four equations are also sufficient. What it means is that if you have a simply connected surface, this is local result. So you can assume that the surface is simply connected. You take a simply connected surface endowed with a metric, with the second fundamental form, with the function nu, a certain function nu, and a certain vector field t satisfying this, then if the Gauss and Kodaly equation are satisfied, and also these two additional surfaces equation are satisfied, then you can recover the immersion. You have an isometric immersion with this prescribed object. So, we will see tomorrow that it will be very important to get something called the Lawson correspondence, a generalization of Lawson's correspondence. It will be the first step in having this Lawson correspondence. But to finish this talk, I would like to mention what is called the Abresh-Rosenberg differential. So, what is the motivation of this? What is Hopf's proof of the theorem of uniqueness of CMC spheres? It's very simple, actually. The main tool is that you have an object called the Hopf differential, which is a holomorphic quadratic differential for CMC surfaces in R3. So, on a sphere, this object must vanish. Something holomorphic on the sphere vanishes, on the whole sphere. And this means, actually, that the surface is totally umbilical. And so it's a round sphere, because it's compact. In the case of E kappa tau, this Hopf differential also exists, but it is not holomorphic anymore. So the idea of Abresh and Rosenberg to prove the uniqueness of spheres in E kappa tau was to look for another quadratic differential which should be holomorphic. And they found the formula. And the object is the following. So it's a little bit complicated. It has two terms. Q of xy is A times this. Plus B times this. Where A and B are complex numbers. And it turns out that this object is holomorphic if A and B satisfy a certain equation, which is written in the notes. So this is holomorphic if two H plus I tau A, B, sorry, plus kappa minus 4 tau square B, A, is zero. So this is the result of Abresh and Rosenberg for CMC H surface in E kappa tau. So, maybe in one sentence I will explain what you need for the proof. Well, you have to compute the derivative of Q with respect to x plus ijx is 0. This is the meaning of being holomorphic. And what you need, basically, is the Kodaly equation and this equation here. But you only need the necessary part. You don't need the sufficient part. The hard part in the first isometric immersion theorem is the fact that there are sufficient conditions. The fact that they are necessary is something which is quite immediate. The Gauss and Kodaly equation are always necessary. And this just comes from this equation. So here, in Avrech and Rosenberg, they only need the necessary part of the previous theorem. So they need these two equations, and when you do the computations, it turns out that if this equation is satisfied, then this is holomorphic. And this actually is just the classical Hopf differential. So this is a classical Hopf differential, and this is another additional term that, again, involves the projection T of the vertical field Xi. Okay, so I will stop here for today, and actually Pablo, I think, will give another proof of this using a conformal parametrization of the surface. So you have several types of proof of this. The original proof of Avrech and Rosenberg is using the Gauss-Kodaly equations, but you can also prove this using a conformal parameter, and actually it's simpler when you use a conformal parameter. Okay, so thank you for your attention.
Take a group photo now, right outside.